What we've done so far is we started off talking about terminology so we can communicate with each other. And then we said basically, hey, this is a data analysis class. We need to figure out how to collect data. So that's what chapter two is all about. And then we went on and said, now that we've collected the data, we need to start working with it. The first thing we want to do is look at the data. So we started talking about different ways to create pictures of your data. Now that we have the ability to look at the data as a picture of it, we now want to start summarizing the data numerically. And the first form of numerical summarizations we're going to talk about are measurements of location and position. Now, here are the learning objectives we want to just briefly go over to make sure that you get this out of the next series of videos. First of all, we want to compute and interpret the location of the center of a data set along a number line. We want to compute and interpret the position of data. See, there's a difference between location and position relative to other data values for a data set. We want to identify the appropriate measure of the center, the appropriate measure of the center for a data set based on distributional shape. Previously, we talked about different shapes of the data. So now, based on that data, that's going to help us decide which is the single most appropriate measurement of the center of our data. So let's start off talking here about measurements of location. When we talk about measurements of location, we're actually making reference to where along the number line the center of the data is located. See, here's a number line, and it starts at 0, and this is 40, and up here is 50. So where's the center? If I look at this, the center is roughly here. So this would be one measure of the center. The center here, this data is skewed, so it's questionable what you want to use for the center, but most people probably argue the center is probably somewhere around here. So this would be a numerical value. So this numerical value for this data set, this value for this data set, would tell us where on the number line the center, and the word center, I'm going to put in quotes because it has more than one meaning, where the center is located. And likewise here, this value would tell us where the center of this data set is located. And very commonly, when we're making comparisons between two groups, that's exactly what we're doing. We're looking at the center for one group, the center for the other group, because quite often we think of the center of the distribution as the most typical values. And we make a comparison between these centers. And that's what helps tells us whether these groups are actually different or they're so close to each other we can't tell if they're different or not. So these measurements are referred to as measurements of central tendency, the center, central tendency. And the three measurements that we're going to talk about are first the mean, the median, and the mode. All three of these are measurements of central tendency. So let's start off with the sample mean. Now, the sample mean, in English, we call it just like I said, the mean. Now, we have both sample and parameter means. The parameter, the symbol for the parameter, we use a Greek letter mu. It's like a U with a long leading tail. The statistic is X bar. Now, I used X bar because that's suggesting that the variable is X. If the variable happens to be Y, it would be Y bar. If your variable happened to be smiley face, it would be smiley face bar. It's the bar that says this is a sample average. The parameter mu is simply mu, although we do quite often use a subscript. If my variable in my data was X, I may make reference to mu sub X, or mu sub y, or obviously mu sub smiley. Now, what does this measure? It measures the center as a balancing point. That's what the mean does. The mean measures the center as a balancing point. Now, the mean is the most common measurement for the center. Almost everybody understands what a mean is. You don't have to do too much explanation of the mean. we will talk a bit more in detail about the mean, but like I said, most people, when you start talking about averages, the mean, people immediately understand that. To calculate the mean, you have to have at least interval data. That means interval or ratio data. The average for nominal data doesn't make any sense. If you had blonde hair and brown hair and red hair and gray hair, what's the average of that? See, that doesn't make any sense. And it is a balancing point, like I said up here. Now, let's go ahead and talk about calculating the mean. Mathematically, this representation tells you exactly how to calculate the mean. This big capital Greek-looking E thing is actually the Greek letter sigma. And what it means is add them up. So what this is actually saying is take data value x1 plus data value x2 plus all the way out to data value xn and divide it by n. Now you know that. Everybody knows how, I think, to calculate an average. You add up all the numbers, divide by the number of numbers. That's exactly what this is telling you to do, but it's very concise, very compact. So in this case, this is considered data values 32, 31, and 30. Well, in the order that's written here, x1 would be 32, x2 would be 1, and x3 would be 30. So this obviously, this case, n equals 3. So to calculate the mean, if I'm going to use x as my variable, x bar would be 1 over 3 times the sum, I equals 1 to 3 of the xi's. So the I, first time through, is a 1. So this means 1 over 3 times x1. And then a second time through, I increments, so now it's 2. So this would be x2 plus x2. The next time through, I increments, and it's 3 plus x3. Now see, this 3 up here says stop at 3. And that's exactly what this formula is telling you to do. This is adding up all the numbers and dividing by 3, which is the same as multiplying by 1 third. So in this case, this would be 32 plus 1 plus 30 divided by 3, which is 63 divided by 3, which is 21. So the sample average, x bar, for this data is 21. Now remember I said that the average is a balancing point. So what does that mean here? Well, let's just draw a quick number line. And let's see here, we went to 32. So let's do, say, 10, 20, 30, 40. That is absolutely more than enough. Okay, so we had a data value over here at 1. We had a data value at 30. And another data value at 32. And then the sample average we found to be right here at 21. This is x bar. So what we're claiming is that numerically this is a balancing point. Well, what does it mean to be a balancing point? Well, if I take each value, so I could take 1, subtract from it the average, 1 minus 21, that equals a negative 20. The next value is 30. 30 minus 21, that equals 9. And then I have here 32 minus 21, that equals 11. And if I add all these up, I get 0. So anything to the left of the mean would give me a negative when I subtract the mean from it. Anything to the right of the mean would give me a positive when I subtract the mean from it. So this balancing point balances the negative and the positive. Now, these were three very simple data values, so this calculation was extremely nice and easy to do. But it doesn't matter if the numbers are integers like this and the average come out to be a nice integer, or if you ended up with decimal values. This is going to happen every single time. Now, it may vary slightly only because of rounding. If you did have a bunch of decimal values, you may not get 0. You may have like a negative 0.001 or a positive 0.001 or something like that. You may be off just a tad because of rounding, but that's the only reason. If you use exact values all the way through, you will get 0 every time, regardless of the values in your data set. So going back up to here, we just calculated X bar, the sample average, and that is one measurement of the center based on a balancing point. Now, if this distribution like this is symmetric, which this is pretty symmetric, then the sample average can be very, very close to what we would visually think of as the center. But in this case over here, where this data set is not symmetric, we can clearly see, hang on, let me get rid of some of that. There we go. We can clearly see that this is skewed right. What's going to happen is the average is going to get pulled in this direction. It's not going to be what we think of as a visual center. It's going to be over in here someplace. I don't know exactly where because I need the data values to figure it out. Here, like I said, the X bar would be very close to what we think of as visually in the center.